lantern.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are broadcasting live from planet X-31, 20 billion light years away from planet Earth. And yes, I am at X-31, and you are at Science and Cocktails on planet Earth. Science and Cocktails is a lecture series organized by the Niels Bohr Institute and Boons Loos, such that science and scientific research can reach all of you Earthlings in first hand. Science only reaches people through the media, and in most cases, completely distorted. Science and Cocktails tries to give a unique experience, such that science and scientific research reaches on. That is how I like it. Tonight we have three very special guests. Von Lundsgaard Hansen, Professor Emeritus of Mathematics at the Danish Technical University, author of several popular science books and of many mathematical articles in the areas of geometry, topology, and global analysis, has been teleported here today from who the hell knows where, and is going to make you see geometry everywhere. He's going to take you on a tour through the abstract thoughts to the Platonic world and make you see the weirdness of reality. While an accurate picture of nature will be given by von Lundsgaard Hansen, an artistic representation will simultaneously be given by the artist and creative mind, Henrik Schulze. After a session of questions and answers, that will take place at the bar, where chilled cocktails with liquid nitrogen are being prepared. Jakob Kierkegaard, some artist who focuses on scientific and aesthetic aspects of time, resonance, and sound, will be presenting his work Labyrinthesis, based on recordings of his own inner ear, and which will use all of you as a big experiment and transform this room in a huge resonant box. End of transmission.
Okay, please give an applause to von Lundsgaard Hansen.
Thank you very much for this introduction to a very marvelous place. I have already met several very interesting people and even some very, very sweet children out here. So it's obviously a nice place to be. And certainly I have never experienced anything like this before. So let the talk now begin. The old Greek thinkers, in particular Plato, were convinced that nature follows mathematical laws. And this belief has dominated thinking about natural phenomena ever since, as witnessed so strongly in major works by physicists such as the Italian Galileo Galilei in the early 1600s, the English Isaac Newton in his work on gravitation in Principia Mathematica from 1687, and the Scottish James Clerk Maxwell in his major work on electromagnetism in 1865. In 1610, Galileo Galilei, often considered the founder of modern science, has said it very clearly in his short book, Sidereus Nuncius, meaning the starry messenger, and we quote from this. Natural philosophy is written in that great book that lies eternally spread before our eyes. I mean the universe. But we cannot understand it before we learn the language and learn to understand the symbols in which it is written. The book is written in the mathematical language, and the symbols are triangles, circles, and other geometrical figures without whose help it is impossible to comprehend a single word, and without which we wander through a dark labyrinth in vain. In his remarkable book on growth and form, published in 1917, the Scottish zoologist Darcy Wentwood Thompson concluded that wherever we cast our glance, we find beautiful geometrical forms in nature. Just think of the enchanting patterns in the wing of the butterfly, the fascinating symmetries in plants, and the fantastic shell construction one finds among snails and mussels. There's much to be gained from a mathematical and engineering point of view by studying the shapes in nature. And in this lecture, we shall follow a line from geometry in nature to some of the manifestations of mathematics in shapes, in architecture, in engineering. And here you see an outline of my lecture, and I hope that you can put it in a better shape. Jay, where are you? You should put it in some better shape. Laura, right, okay. It's just a technical point. Right, but this gave you some time to look at the plan for my lecture. As indicated, the book of geometry lays open right before our eyes. And most people, I'm sure, have admired the beautiful shells in snails and shellfish constructed by nature. And I shall consider the spiral curve in such a shell from a mathematical point of view. The curve you find in a snail is a so-called logarithmic spiral. And in the snail, it is a peaceful expression of exponential growth. You should be careful with exponential growth. This is dangerous. I'll come back to it. A particular perfect logarithmic spiral in nature is found in the shell of a primitive cuttlefish called the Nautilus. The logarithmic spiral is clearly visible here, and it is a picture of a postcard, and as you can see, it is from the world mathematical year 2000. Actually, I hold the postcard here in my hand to testify that it really does exist. The shape of a logarithmic spiral is perturbed by an arbitrary scaling up or down. And due to this high degree of self-similarity, logarithmic spirals play a dominant role in the fascinating pictures you see of fractals. It's also the self-similarity which makes it possible to thicken a logarithmic spiral in a sausage with exponentially growing thickness so that the sausage can be wound up into a solid with the outside of one layer exactly fitting up against the inside of the next, and thereby produce a shape looking very much like the shell of a snail. And if you understand the construction, you can produce a very lifelike nautilus on a computer. And that's one of the things I shall return to. You can also find logarithmic spirals in flowers. And this is a postcard
And here I hold it in my hand, also from the World Mathematical Year 2000. And here you can watch the spiral curves coming up like this, or if you go the other way, you also have spiral curves. And these spiral curves are also logarithmic spirals. Again, here it is result of exponential growth. There are 21 curves going anti-clockwise, and there are 34 curves turning clockwise. You can't count them, but if you do, I have counted them, put a thing in here, and then if you count right, there are 21 anti-clockwise and 34 curves turning clockwise. And the numbers 24 and 34 is a pair of consecutive Fibonacci numbers. And Fibonacci numbers, you know, 1, 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, 5 plus 8 is 13, and 8 plus 13 is 21, and 13 plus 21 is 34. I just explained to you why 21 and 34 are Fibonacci numbers. And there are good mathematical reasons that Fibonacci numbers often occur in connection with botanical phenomena in nature. It has to do with the way the leaves are sitting, and if you take an ananas and count the curves, I can't remember whether it's 5 and 8 there or something. If you take one of these marvelous ananas and count, then you will see also one way and the other way, there are two consecutive Fibonacci numbers. It's really funny, and it has to do with Fibonacci numbers. When you go out to the limit, take the quotient between two Fibonacci numbers and go to the limit, it goes to the golden section. And this is the most irrational number you can think of. And due to this irrationality, it's nice for the leaves, etc., to follow these things. And they will get much sun and whatever they like. And now that's what I have written down here. There is a little, because it was to the mathematical year, of course there are exercises at the bottom of the postcard. And why, and so on, and like this, and what has that to do with everything in the world? And it is so that if you look on the backside, you will get a World Wide Web address, where you can find a small story about all this. So if you go home and Google, if you don't hate to do Google, then you could Google postcards, World Mathematical Year 2000, WAP. Then you get to things where you can see 8 marvelous postcards, and there are explanations what are on these postcards. A brilliant idea. Actually, may I say that in the year 2000, I was chairman of the European Mathematical Society's Committee for Preparing the World Mathematical Year 2000. And in this capacity, I made a competition where they should set in posters. As soon as these posters came in, immediately a close relative of mine, my dear wife, said, they look like postcards. And yes, they look like postcards. We made them into postcards, and you see, here they are. And they were translated in many, many languages, so they're both in France and Canada and Italy and Spain and many, and Germany. And so there are very many places. So this idea of looking at these posters and saying, that's postcards, inspired quite a lot, I will say. So now we don't need to talk more about these. Now, exponential growth does not develop with the speed of a snail. At any moment, the growth rate in exponential growth is proportional to the size already gained. So you have a certain size. then you grow with a velocity which is a constant time that size. So when you get big, you grow fast and fast. So this is really tremendous growth. Grow with a speed proportional to the size you already have. If you start growing exponentially, boom, it takes only a minute, yet they are sitting all over the room here. And that looks ugly, so I have decided not to grow exponentially. Economists, they do fear exponential growth. For an economy, this form of growth is attached to unpleasant things like compound interest. I can tell you that means rentes rente. And this leads to galloping debt if you don't keep it under control. Okay, there are other more peaceful spirals. For example, the spiral curve in the cake Swiss roll, in Danish, chokolade. I admit, admittedly, I have never made a chokolade roulade, but I have seen one being made. And there you see this spiral in there, in this, made by the stuff we really like, if we are men. This spiral you see there, it's a so-called Archimedean spiral. And it is thought that the famous Archimedes, that he used this spiral in addition to ruler, a lineal and compass, one to draw circles with passer. So Archimedes is thought to have used this spiral together with lineal or passer, ruler and compass, in order to solve the classical problem. If you have a circle with a given area, you would like using only lineal and passer, ruler and compass. Out from a given circle, you want with ruler and compass to construct a square having the same area as the circle. That's what they really tried to do, these old Greeks. Given a circle, with ruler and compass, construct a square having the same area. And they tried, and they tried, and they tried, and they didn't succeed. But Archimedes, if he in addition also used this spiral curve there inside, then he could solve it. And I could here make an advertisement for Den Store Danske Encyklopædie. If you go to the Danish National Encyclopedia and look at all this stuff here, cirklens kvadratur is the magic word, squaring the circle is the name. If you look, cirklens kvadratur, then you will get what I just told you, plus a drawing at the margin showing what it was Archimedes did. Okay, so he did not do it the right way because he used also this spiral. And more than 2,000 years later, one found out that squaring the circle with ruler and compass is impossible. It could not be done. I will tell you straight on, there are people who tries. There are even people who tries even after they have told you. They go home and try and try and try and think that they can do it. But it can be mathematically proved that you cannot do it. Not even any kind of God can do it. It's impossible. In the most clear way, it's simply not possible. And why is it not possible? It's because this nice number called pi, it is a transcendental number. Wow. That means that you cannot make a polynomial expression, 2x plus 3x to the 4th minus 15x to the 17th. You can make no polynomial expression with integer coefficients, so that if you put pi in on the x's place, then it cannot be zero. No matter what polynomial you make with integral coefficients, then if you put pi in, it will be different from zero. So what I'm just saying to the informed people is that pi is not a root in a polynomial equation with integer coefficients. Wow, that's what I... And such unpleasant numbers are called transcendental. And in 1872, it was proved by a German mathematician called Lindemann that pi is transcendental, and then you knew that this implies that you cannot square the circle. And I must tell you one joke because it's necessary, because you see, it is so that in the old days it was used as a synonym of absolute stupidity if you said, this guy tries to square the circle. Then everybody knows that it is impossible. So it is a good way of saying, this guy tries to do the impossible things. And among politicians, it was used, I heard it used by a politician. I'm absolutely certain the person would not know what squaring the circle was, but she said, in the parliament, this honored member of our parliament tries to square the circle. And then I always tell people, if you see someone say this, then you should put your finger and ask, well, what does that mean? And then see what they react. And then if they say, I don't know, then you can tell them what it is. And then either you get kicked out or you are immediately elected chairman of the society. So this is a good check for something very useful. So now I have done some useful things for you today. And now I'll go on, because now I have, in a pure mathematical way, I have to define a spiral. And you should not be surprised. It looks very complicated now, because I want to say it mathematically. You know, a spiral is something spiraling out from a point, or maybe it spirals in towards a point. You all know what a spiral is, but now I'll try to make it difficult so you don't know what it is. So I will consider a particle moving in the plane, and then I say there are two basic motions you can do. You could do unbounded motion along a line, and you can make a periodic motion in a continuous periodic motion around a central point. That's also what we call rotation. And now comes the thing. If we have an unbounded motion along a line, and at the same time the line rotates about one of its endpoints, so you have a particle moving out on a line, and at the same time this line make a rotation. If you do that, wow, you get a spiral motion. Jesus, man, you got a spiral motion here, and it has a spiral point. So I'm very happy now. Everybody should be completely calm. This was a straight mathematical definition. I was thinking like mad, how on earth can I define a thing which everybody knows in advance in such a way that afterwards they don't know what it is anyhow. Okay. Now I'm prepared to tell you what an Archimedean spiral is. An Archimedean spiral, there, it's a spiral where you have the movement along a line goes with constant velocity, and the rotation of the line also goes with constant velocity. So here comes a nice particle. It starts out there and goes out there, constant velocity, and at the same time this line turns around. And now you see here, if you haven't done anything else, now I'll tell you, if you have a center at the point and you have an oriented axis here, then you can give all points in the plane a so-called polar coordinate. You just say what the angle theta you have turned, and then you tell how far you have gone out of the line. So there you have polar coordinates in the plane. And now I can tell you, yoo-hoo, the Archimedean spiral is simply defined by this equation, r is equal to a constant times theta. So now you know what an Archimedean spiral is. Okay, what about the logarithmic spiral? Aha, in this case, the movement in the rotation is constant, but the movement in the line is with exponentially growing velocity. So it goes, it starts very slowly, and then the velocity is growing exponentially, so it gets faster and faster and faster and faster. So eventually, just boom, it goes out there incredibly fast. And then you also here have polar coordinates, and I can tell you what is the formula for a logarithmic spiral. It is the radius r here is a constant a positive times this exponential function b theta, whatever this exponential function is, but you can hear that exponential has something to do with exponential growth, and that's not so. This is the formula for a logarithmic spiral. Now, if you came in here totally unprepared, I can calm you down and say I can also define a logarithmic spiral in another way. There is an alternative definition which can be explained to everybody, I suppose, because a logarithmic spiral is the same as an equiangular spiral. Equi means same, angular means angle, vinkel. So it means angle, yes. So it's something, a spiral which has the same angle. So what is it which should be the same angle? And that is, the tangent to the curve makes an angle with the line from the origin to the point. So the tangent here makes an angle u with the line out from center. And this angle u should be constant along the curve. So, the first thing I announce to you this evening now, in the great battle, if you come with a logarithmic spiral, and it is a logarithmic spiral in this sense, it is also an equiangular spiral. Namely, the angle which the tangent to the curve makes with the line to the center is constant all the way around. And the magnificent thing is, if you come with a spiral curve where this angle u here is constant all the way around, then you can prove mathematically, solving technically a simple differential equation, and it ends up with this formula there. So it's one and the same thing to say I have a logarithmic spiral and I have an equiangular spiral. The advantage by the last definition is, of course, that it could be explained sort of reasonably easy. And now I am able to tell you how the spider makes its web. Then the spider is hungry, it has to make a web to catch all things. And what do the spider do? The first thing, it makes a Y-shaped figure by fastening the ends of this Y to some points in the surroundings, maybe up in the roof of a, and then one down to the earth. Then you have such a Y-shaped figure. And what does it then do? It makes a frame. You see, you can believe that the Y comes something there. So it makes a frame around this center in the web. And then it makes radial lines out from the center to the boundary of the frame. And then it holds these things together with a logarithmic spiral starting from the inside. It just makes quick move, so it comes out to the boundary, and this quick move is made along a logarithmic spiral. And then it stops, and then it starts producing sticky klister, sticky thread. And then it works its way back with sticky thread hanging out behind. It works its way along an Archimedean spiral until it comes to the center. And while it goes back to the center, it eats the logarithmic spiral used in the construction, because such thing demands energy, and the poor little creature needs to eat it up to have energy to make. So now it's completely exhausted, and now it's ready for catching things. Having this explained, spiders are to me the foremost architect in nature. And therefore, I always warn my spiders when I clean in my room, because I always shout, "I'm coming," so that they can get away before I'm there cleaning them up. So it's really fantastic that this creature there has that in the genes. And I can tell you, people, if you give them some LSD, that has been tried, gave them LSD, and do you know what happened? They are completely unable to make the net. It gets totally confused. And so I'm sure if you gave them corresponding to a bottle of whiskey or something like that, then they will also be unable to make anything. So I have a special relationship with these things. Now we turn to something else, because many gross phenomena in nature exhibit curvature. And what I'm doing now, I will discuss the shape of the shell of this primitive cuttlefish called the Nautilus. And around 1990, I suggested a new computer model of a Nautilus shell. And in this model, I was able to prove mathematically an often postulated relation between the logarithmic spiral and the golden section. It has been claimed, it is claimed in many books, that there is a relation between this logarithmic spiral and the golden section. And after, I don't know it's when it's after me, but for many years it was wrong in all books. Now they are a little more reluctant, because the spiral which they use to prove that it has anything to do with it is not a logarithmic spiral, but it's a so-called Fibonacci spiral. But I was very, very pleased when I discovered in my mathematical model an April night in 2001, I discovered that in my mathematical model, it was absolutely perfect. So I could not sleep for 3 weeks after that, so excited I was. And now, you see, the construction of this computer model of a Nautilus shell is based on knowledge about the notion of curvature of smooth curves in the plane. So now I offer to you a free course in what is meant by the curvature of plane curves. You see, that's why I like all this. I like to find mathematics everywhere. And because now I can give you a little introduction to curvature, which is, you see, that's things, when you study nature, you look for symmetry, rotation symmetry, this is like this, and mirror image, I look sort of mirror image. So reflected, that's symmetry considerations. And then curvature, symmetry and curvature, that's what the physicists like when they should explain nature. Symmetry is measured by something called groups, and curvature is like gravitation. Wow. So curvature is that's very important. And now you get a free course in what is meant by curvature of a plane curve. What you see here is a curve moving in the plane. And now I tell you, in the point P naught here, there is a line approximating the curve best possible. And this is, of course, the tangent line. That's the best linear approximation to the curve in the neighborhood of P naught. That's the best linear, that is the tangent line. And the tangent line, obviously, there's no curvature in that. Oh, wow, why is he telling you this? Because you can also approximate with something better. You can approximate with a circle. There is a circle which best possible approximate the curve in the neighborhood of P naught. And the circle is something with second degree, so this circle will be the best possible second degree approximation to the curve in P naught. That circle which does that is called the circle of curvature. And therefore, what is the center called? The center of curvature. And what is the radius called? The radius of curvature. And you see, mathematicians like Greek letters, so it's of course a rho. And now we are prepared. The curvature of the plane curve at P naught is numerically 1 divided by rho. It's called kappa, krumling, k, kappa. And the numerical value of the curvature is 1 divided by the radius here. And now you see a small radius makes a huge curvature. 1 divided by something very small is very big. And if the radius is colossal, like the radius of the Earth, then it's almost zero. And it's sort of is okay with our intuition. If you have a small circle, ooh, it curves a lot, and a big circle doesn't curve at all. So it's a sensible thing. If I want to make the curvature at P naught, I take that circle, called the circle of curvature, which best possible approximates the curve here at P naught. And then the sine, then the curvature numerically is 1 divided by the radius in the circle of curvature. So this is good. But now you see there's also a sine here. That's because normally a plane has a preferred sense of rotation. And for some reason, mathematicians always want it to be anti-clockwise. We are anti-everything, so we are also anti the clock. So, and if you now go anti the clock, what is that anti-clockwise? When you go anti-clockwise, you are turning to the left. You see, anti-clockwise, I turn to the left. And if I go clockwise, I turn to the right. So now I give the curvature a sign. If I turn to the right, that is, I follow the clock, then the curvature has a minus sign. If I turn to the left, so I'm anti-clockwise, then the curvature should have the sign plus. So now I have explained everything but the curvature of a plane curve is at a point, P naught. And of course, then there could be some situations where this construction makes no sense. For example, the curve could be a piece of line, or it could be an inflection point, as it's called. And if this is the case, then we simply put the curvature to zero. I have told you everything now. This is what plane curvature is about. It was the truth, the full truth, and nothing but the full truth. So now you know what curvature is. I'm very pleased, so I told you that. I have taught you something interesting now. And now I can start constructing my computer notions. Now you see here, on the scene comes a nice logarithmic spiral, or as we know, it's an equiangular spiral. The angle which The tangent to the curve makes with the line from the center is constant along the curve. Such a thing I take. And now I have told you that at each point you have a circle of curvature. And what do? With this circle of curvature, I take it out of the plane, and then I place it orthogonal to the plane of the curve, and also orthogonally to the curve itself. And the center of curvature is now placed at the curve. So at each point, I take my circle of curvature, take it out, and orthogonal to the plane of the curve, and orthogonal also to the curve. Okay, now if I do that, now you have to think a little bit. Now, if at each point I take this circle of curvature, and then this circle of curvature I place in here. So here comes my, you see, here comes my equiangular spiral, down, and then I take the curvature, circles of curvature, and put them around it. Can you see a horn coming out? Can you see a Waldhorn or something like that? Can you see this coming out? Ein Waldhorn oder ein Ohrflödes Horn, which you can look at the baker. It comes out here, you know. Ooh. And yes, it's a nice horn, because it's now you have this image, of this sausage there, or whatever it is. You have that image because on the next slide I'm simply going to make a cross section of it. So here in the space you have the section horn coming up, and then comes this stupid guy, that's me, and cut it there, and then. What do we see? We see something like this. Now, if this angle up there was very small, there will be gaps in the horn. There will be gaps in the horn if it was very small. If it's very big, everything goes into itself and makes intersection. And now came my discovery, the 33 of April 2001, I discovered at 3 o'clock in the night that there was exactly one angle U for which it was so that it just rolled up one layer fitting exactly against the next. Wow, when I had found this angle experimentally, and I made it roll for 8 times, and I looked, wow, he follows all the way. I got exceedingly happy. Because in a book, many years before, I had actually in here said that you could do something like this. And then I was challenged by a TV journalist to make a model of it. And when I made the model, the first thing I discovered was, wow, there was a gap. Then I made it big, the angle, it got a mess. And then I took it completely calm, and then I experimented. I made experimental mathematics. And wow, certainly it was there. And what was the angle which made it work, roll up? It was half of it. It was half of 137.5 degrees. Exactly for half of 137.5 degrees. If that was the angle, then it rolled perfect up. And do you know what I then found out? Then I found out, you see, here you have a chord in the circle. And you have a chord in the circle, and this chord divide this circle into two arcs. And then I found out that the angle of this arc was exactly the angle which satisfies the following scene. The great arc measured in angles, the great arc divided by the small arc is equal to the full circle divided by the big arc. And this means that the chord has divided the circle in the golden ratio. Because the golden ratio is exactly that, the ratio which makes such that the great arc is related to the small arc in the same way as the full circle is related to the big circle. So, and if the chord here, a chord in a curve is a line connecting two points on the curve, here is a chord, and this chord divides the circle in the golden ratio. The big thing relates to the small thing as the full circle to the large thing. Aha! And then when it is so, then this small arc is called the golden angle. And the golden angle is, as I said, approximately 135.5 degrees. And now I teach you something about angles, because this angle here is a chord tangent angle. So it's a chord tangent angle. And such an angle is measured by half of this arc here. So this angle up here is half the golden angle. And this angle just made it roll up so that you get the nice thing, and now we are prepared for it. Here I have made a transparent model exactly that way, and I can also make it a solid. And now, since no living animals are in here, then I can easily divide it into two. So here have the top and the bottom. And now I won't click on the thing down there, but if I clicked on there, I will get something from my home page. If you get mathematical Nautilus shell, von Lundsgaard Hansen, if you write that in Google, then you will be directed to which is actually an original result proved by me. And of course, I'm very proud of this, and I like that. I'm sorry. I must say that. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Det minder mig om sommer i Tyrol, der er også en konge, han går altid rundt og siger, thank you. So, thank you very much. Okay, that was a good thing, because now we turn to something different. On the scene, you see a right circular cylinder. That's a right, because there's a right angle here, it's a right circular cylinder. And such a right circular cylinder I could produce keeping a stick. You can imagine, do you see a long stick here in my hand? And then I turn that stick. Then the stick sweeps out. It sweeps out. Oh, sorry. Shut up. Yeah, there. it was myself, I said, shut up to. And this right circular, now this circular, right circular cylinder here, it is filled with generators, lines upstairs, filled with generators. And then I can make a curve, and this curve is called a helix. It's the curve where the tangent to the curve always intersect all the generating lines in a fixed constant angle. Such a curve which spirals its way upward in such a way that the angle between the tangent and the generator is constant, that's a so-called helix. And if you make it with your right hand, whew, you get a right-handed helix. And if you follow a right-handed helix, you turn to the left. That's rather funny. And if you make a left-handed helix, you actually turn to the right. So this is funny, I suppose, because you see, in nature, you can find such curves in bindweed. Bindweed follows such helices, and most bindweed follows a right-handed helix. For example, what is it? It's called, now I must look at it, I forgot it, what it's called. Most follow, bindweed. That was what I called bindweed. Shut up, man. So a bindweed follow a right-handed. But hops, you know, the things where you can make beer out of, it follows a left-handed. So when you come out in nature and see such a thing which grows enormously and follows, then you can be sure it's a hops. So you can go in there and look and see, here's a hops, and it is left-handed, it follows a left-handed turn. And then you go, here we have some bindweed, it follows a right-handed turn. So you can go around and enjoy yourself with this. So no more enjoyment about this. So a helix follows in the upward twining the shortest possible path relative to the number of turns. You see, if I have two points sufficiently close to each other, the helix is the shortest path. So in this way, it's very effective. And the helix is found also in the balustrade helenon on a staircase. And Watson and Crick discovered in 1953 that DNA molecules lies in double helices, and they won the Nobel Prize for that in 1962. So this was a huge discovery. So in large and small encounters, one meets the helix. And why is it so? It's because it's effective. And now here's a piece of poetry which I made myself. So I just read it up. So it's no, mathematics has permanent residence in the shapes showing up in the many wonders of nature. If you see the underlying mathematical structure, you have access to the powerful universal methods in mathematics, which are tied together by the overview gained by abstraction. For the strength of mathematics is to be found in the interplay between the concrete and the abstract. So that's my main model. Mathematics is something which goes on in here. It is abstract. If there's no abstraction, it's no mathematics. If there's nothing concrete related to it, it's most likely not so interesting. So combination of the abstract and the concrete things, that's where the real strength is. So that's why I like it. So now we shall see how some geometrical shapes appear in architecture. For example, we have the helices. The helices, they are banisters in winding stairs. What way does it go? It goes that way, yes. And so a winding stair architect, it's winding stairs if there are no interior cylinder in it. It's a spiral staircase if there is an interior cylinder inside. So now you know what the difference between, for architects, winding stairs, no interior cylinder, and spiral staircase, there is an interior cylinder. I learned that the hard way by making mistakes in it, and then an architect came and told me how it was. And now, look here. You have a winding stair. You consider it as lines radiating out from the center. So, for example, if I have a stick here and a line there, and then it could, by some mechanism, go up there. Then I just give it a bang, woo, 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 woo. Then it sweeps out such a nice surface as we see in the round tower. And this nice surface we see in the round tower, this is a so-called helicoid. So I already indicated that the helicoid here in the spiral staircase, and it's built up of lines radiating from the center, and it's curved. So this is really interesting. You can make curved things out of lines. Great. And now you see here, I have been there myself and paid €2 to climb the tower in Palazzo Contarini del Bovolo Venedi. It's not worth the money, but I got a whole lot of people to go with me to the top for €2. And so the guy could make a living out of this. So, but it was not in 1949, though, I wait. Well, yeah, maybe it was 1949. No, it wasn't. Okay. So now I will come to something which I'm very proud of. Now, look here, you have a right circular cylinder, and it's a tower. And in that tower, you have a spiral staircase following the wall. And now it's a spiral staircase inside this tower. So it intersects all the radial lines in this circular tower. It intersects it all the way along a constant angle. So that's what you have. And now you, inside this tower where you have this spiral staircase, you place yourself on your back and look up the tower, and up the tower there's a roof, and then you see all the generating lines there meet up in the roof as a system of lines radiating out from the center. And the banister of the winding of the spiral staircase, the banister of the spiral staircase intersects the lines here in the tower under the constant angle, and therefore this banister projects up in the tower in a curve which intersects this system of lines radiating out under a constant angle. And we know what this is. This is a logarithmic spiral. Wow. So it was actually the same journalist I discussed my Nautilus. I have tried hard to, she was very intelligent, but not a mathematician, but she was very sharp, and we had an exercise because she wanted to understand all the mathematics to make sure that I did not tell the Danish people anything wrong. So I should convince her. And then when she looked up at my wall, she saw this postcard, and then she said, "Wow, that's the logarithmic spiral." And then I said, "No, because I knew what it was. I knew that it was three spiral staircases inside Museo de Popo Galergo in Santiago in Spain, because they have a tower with three different spiral staircases in. And I knew that it was this, but when, so I said no, and then I said, ah, yes, you are right, but it's a visual illusion. So the first mathematician in the world maybe observed this a visual illusion. So I don't know, I hope it made me happy. I don't know what about you, but nevertheless, I got very happy about it. So now we turn to something completely different. Now, if you have a chain hanging between 2 points, only affected by the weight of gravity, then it will follow a so-called catenary, and in Danish, in kædelinje. And this catenary is not the same as a parabola. A parabola, that's the curve which a projectile follows, or a jet stream of water. Here I have taken a photograph myself in Bung Bung land of this magnificent. I have several hundreds of them if you like them. And so this is a parabola. And this parabola here is different from the catenary, but maybe you can see they sort of look very much alike. And here comes the Great Belt Bridge. And I have here a poster where you see the Great Belt Bridge. And I have made this poster. I have designed this poster. I'm naturally very proud of it. And it's also made in English and also published several places in English. On the text for it is very essential to me, mathematics, bridges, gaps in culture, science and technology. I'm proud of having found out of this. So I had this, then I missed a motive on my poster. And then suddenly I realized one of my good friends has made in her student examination project, she had made this wonderful drawing here, where you see a drawing on, you see, look at it on the board where you prepare the building of a bridge, and you can see there are some mathematical formulas, and if you look sharp enough, you'll see here something of second degree, and equations with a second degree, people know is a parabola. So one of my good mathematical friends, a very good mathematician in Germany, he wanted to use this poster on the German mathematical homepage for the German Mathematical Society as an example of how mathematics goes into bridges. So he would like that. And then, of course, he could be allowed to that. And then one day he wrote me that one of the person seeing this poster had said, isn't it a parabola up here? And that's wrong, because it should be a chain. It should be a catenary. And then I told to him, no, it is a parabola, because the lines here are not hanging only affected by gravity. They are also affected evenly by the weight of the bridge. And then it can be proved. It's not completely trivial, but on the other hand, it's not terribly difficult either. It's solving a differential equation. Then you can solve if it has an even affection by the bridge, then it will be a parabola. So this formula out here is actually true. It is a parabola. But as I told you, most mathematicians will not know it. So, but now they know it. So thank you to such a poster there. Then many people know it. So that's very good. And now comes something. Now we have just learned about the catenary. Take this catenary and rotate it about a suitable axis. So then rotate, then we come along with this surface here, and this surface is called a catenoid. And the catenoid, it has a marvelous property, namely, it is a minimal surface. And what does it mean to be a minimal surface? That means if you take a sufficiently small piece of the surface, then the catenoid is the smallest possible surface area which is spanned by the curve. So in other hand, if I think of this as being very fixed, solid, and then I perturb it, think of this as a rubber, then the area will be bigger. So it has minimal area inside this small piece. If you were a physicist, you would say it follows the shape of a soap film. So minimal surfaces locally looks like soap films. So this is a perfect definition. And here you see some soap films. It's realized I had taken a trefoil nut, and that trefoil nut I have dipped into glue and let it stiffen, and then I've painted it green, and then you have a nice ear ring if you put it up there and there. And because they come as left-handed and right-handed trefoil knots, so you can have a right-handed trefoil knot hanging in your right ear and a left-handed trefoil knot in your left ear. And you know, it is actually done, so you can buy them. So I have one of my female colleagues, I always tell her, okay, you have bought them to please me. And she says, yes, so she has such a pair of earrings. So they do exist. Okay, here's another minimal surface. And you see there are two things down there. So it looks like a little saddle, but this goes down here. And the famous, the funny mathematician, they are so joke, they call it a monkey saddle, because then the legs could go down here and the tail could go down there. So this is a monkey saddle performed as a minimal surface. And so you could go on. Here you have the helicoid. I have also a green one. I bought the painting myself, half a liter of painting just to make this funny stuff here. And you can easily make it yourself, and they keep on going for long. So now you know what a minimal surface is. And Euler, he proved the famous Euler, 1707 to 1783, around 1740, he proved that the catenoid was a minimal surface. And I say to you, this axis where you rotate it around should be at a specific distance from here in order to work. Then you get a minimal surface, like the catenoid. And you see inside, you have all these stuff running in here. And if you take two circles and dip them, keep them close and dip it in soap water and pull them slightly, you can do it, the experimentarium I do think, then you will see a nice, you can stand inside, yes, in the experimentarium, you can stand inside such a catenoid, take something and lift it up, and you stand in there inside a catenoid. So, yes, so next time you see this, you know what you are doing, you know it's a minimal surface, and you know it was proved by Euler in 1740, that it's the only rotational symmetric minimal surface. Wow, so now you can tell all the interested guys around you that there's something going on there. So we just go back to the round tower, and I have already told you that it's made up of straight lines, and this is very surprising. But another surprising thing, so such a thing which is made out of straight line is called a ruled surface. And ruled surfaces are very useful in construction. For example, when you build ships, it's very good to make them out of ruled surfaces because they fit nicely together. But in addition, it was proved in 1776 by the French mathematician Meunier that this surface is also a minimal surface. And so on small pieces, it exhibits minimal area inside the curve. That's very funny. And now comes the really killer. One can prove that locally, a minimal surface looks like a saddle. So it looks, you know what a saddle is? Something going up. Such a nice saddle surface, you just jump up and it's a hyperbolic parabola. About hyperbolic paraboloid, but it's a saddle-shaped surface. And the minimal surface has to look like that. And if you look carefully, maybe you can see some curves turning this way and some curve turning this way, and it's filled out. So it is a minimal surface. But I say to you that nobody will ever see that it's a saddle shape in there. So next time you come into the round tower, you take a look carefully. Oh yes, I see the saddle in here. And then you go up and I see the saddle everywhere. And I am sure that you will admit that you can only see that using mathematics. Or let's just say it to make me happy. And minimal surfaces, they are very, very popular in engineering and in architecture. Here you have the work of the famous German architect, Frei Otto. And Frey Otto, he has been inspired by soap film models, by minimal services. And here's one of his constructions for the Olympic Stadium in Munich in 1972. But since we are in Denmark, let's not forget Erik Reitzel, who has just recently died. He, together with von Spreckelsen, constructed La Grande Arc, Menneskehedens Triumfbue, in Paris, and got decorated with all kinds of French orders. So, and Erik Reitzel, so I dedicate this to the memory of him. He was very occupied with shapes in nature, and it was also a minimal surface which instructed, which inspired this Grand Arc. So let's say this. And now comes something which I will simply read loud to you, because it's better I read it than I know exactly how long time it takes. If in the evening, at twilight, one takes a walk along the lakes in Copenhagen, one can get a fascinating view of the planetarium, named after the famous Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe. The planetarium has the shape of a cut-off cylinder, and the shape of the curve in the roof is known as an ellipse. This choice of design looks deliberate. When Kepler, in the beginning of the 1600s, published the final laws for the planetary movements, the first law says that the planets follow elliptical orbits around the sun. In this way, the planetarium faces up toward the universe with exactly that shape of curves characteristic of the movements of the planets. Now, if you would like to have a drink after your evening walk, and it is served in a half-filled cone-shaped glass, you'll find that if you hold the glass in a slanted position, the surface of the drink will have the shape of an oval. In this case, too, the boundary curve is an ellipse. If you tilt your head back and pour down the drink, you swallow a hyperbola. And just in passing from ellipse to hyperbola, you taste the parabola. It is no wonder that you might feel dizzy. The story about the drink illustrates that if we make a plane cut in a conic surface, then exactly three different types of intersection curves with a cone can occur: ellipse, parabola, and hyperbola. These so-called conic sections were studied systematically for the first time more than 2,000 years ago by the Greek mathematician Apollonius. Starting from purely mathematical interest, the conic sections have turned out to be useful in many very different contexts. For example, the reflection properties of the ellipse are exploited in kidney stone crushers, and it's true, and those of a parabola in parabolic antennas, which we all use. To realize certain mechanical movements of robots, you need elliptical gear wheel, and the hyperbola is exploited in navigation, the Deca navigator systems, the things which went before GPS systems. Without our thinking about it, the conic sections are part of our daily life in many ways. It's time now to finish this excursion into the world of mathematics. If it has left you with the impression that there's mathematics everywhere, this is hardly coincidence. Thank you for your attention.
We have time for three questions here with all of us together, which is really, really nice. So who would like to ask the question?
What did inspire you to get the proof for the angle and the logarithmic spiral?
It was an American mathematician who told me that one could do something like this, but he did not tell me what to do or anything. So I believed him because it sounded plausible. And then when I actually, it was part of a television program in Viden Om, it was called Naturens Mønster. And there I was, it was more or less the first time there was mathematics in television. And one of the things they told is that you cannot tell anything about mathematics. It's just like nailing jelly to the wall, as they called me. And so they were really controlling me in head and back, whatever I said that it was correct. And they sent this lady out to me. She was very, very quick and very intelligent. She's now PhD in biology. And I explained it very carefully to her. And then when I have explained it to her, then I got the message from her, "Wow, I'm sure that you can make an animation of all this." Wow, then for during 3 weeks, I learned how to use the computer. Because as soon as you get such a task where you cannot admit to somebody that you are unable to do it, so I worked energetically. And then when the day came, I tried just an arbitrary angle, and then I observed, wow, there's gap. Then I a bigger angle, and then it was intersection, it went all up. And then by taking, you see, oh, it's all wrong what I have written in my book, it's wrong all. Then I got calm, and then experimenting, and then suddenly it was there. And now when it was there, I could actually also later on prove it. So I have written a paper about it where it is done in detail. So I will say I was inspired by this talk about logarithmic spirals and the nautilus. And then I was inspired by, or challenged, I would say, by this journalist. You can do it. And then I couldn't, and I couldn't, and then I could. And then I was happy. So that was what it should. So it was a long answer.
Any other question?
The 0 to 10 number system, yeah. As opposed to, for example, the binary system. Is this a useful or problematic number system in describing natural relationships? Like, whereas the analytic mathematics, expressions of relationships and things like that. This is one thing, but 0 to 10, yeah, as a synthetic system, does that represent well the natural system, or is it problematic?
How did one get to have this number system with 10 decimals? It took an awful long time before one came to there. And the number 10 as basic has, of course, to do with that you have 10 fingers. But you have also 10 toes, so 20. There are also systems built on 20 used by the Maya Indians. And you can also just use 2, and the Romans more or less used 5. So you can use everything you want. Every number you give, you can develop a number system. But in 10 has the magnificent thing that you only need 10 symbols. For example, if you have used, as they did in the old Babylonia, 60, then you should have had 60 signs. And it's difficult to remember 24 letters in the alphabet. What about 60 signs? So the 10 turned out simply to be effective. It's easy to handle. So that's the reason we had this. But you know, the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up, they are to 9, then they are sort of natural. The 0 there is problematic. It was first introduced in 628. So before 628, they did not know anything called 0.
Europeans didn't know.
Yeah, Europeans didn't know, but there were no symbols for it. But negative numbers were also first discovered. It was discovered in India, actually. Negative numbers were. One began to use negative numbers also in 628. So it's very interesting how this developed. But the only thing you can say is that 10 simply beat them all. For example, in Europe, the 10 decimals, it was simply introduced in the French Revolution, they say, now we go decimal during the French Revolution, because the Roman numerals, they were used right up to this. So I don't know whether it's, at least I said something, I don't know whether it answered your question.
Is there any other question? Or?
I would like to ask, I saw the other ask for base 11 because he mentioned the numbers from 0 to 10.
Yeah.
Is it known about base 11? Is it used anywhere?
Not that I know of. I don't think so, but you could, if you would.
Of course you could.
Yes. But the binary system, of course, has become very useful after you have on and off. So this is definitely
useful. Has been mentioned that the ape that took his cameras out of the forest down in Africa, he could count to 11 because he had 5 fingers on the right and 5 fingers on the left.
Yeah.
And then the one in the middle.
Yeah. Okay, very nice, very good.
Very good. I like that joke. And
okay, maybe we can start.
I'm lucky enough to understand it.
Okay, let's thank Professor Von again. And, if you have any further questions, you can just ask Professor Von at the bar or whatever you want. And we're going to have a 20-minute break, and then Jakob Kierkegaard is going to present his work Labyrinthitis, where he basically recorded the sound from the inner ear, and the effect you have on your own ears when he plays these frequencies is a bit weird. So if you're up for a weird experience, you should stick around. Thanks.